Today I want to share with you a little tip about rotoscoping, specifically how you correctly use temporary shapes. When rotoscoping, we often break down objects or persons into lots of different shapes, and the reason is it's easier for animation. So let's say you want to rotoscope my head. You could use one shape, but once I turn my head, the silhouette changes quite a lot, right? So you have my ears or a relatively straight shape here, but once I turn, you see my nose, and that's quite different, but it may be only different for a few frames. So the correct approach for this is to bring in a new shape which covers this temporary problem and bring this shape in for just a few frames and then remove it again. And this is what I'm covering here. This course is taken out of my compositing course, where I have a full chapter on rotoscoping and show you how I break down the human anatomy with multiple shapes and do it in a consistent way, consider motion blur, etc., etc. But now just a tiny little tip. If you want to see the full course, have a look at my website. But before that, enjoy this video. Sometimes you get shapes which are not needed throughout the whole timeline. Actually, that's pretty common. So if something is rotating or so, a shape may not be needed all the time. So when I look at the legs, for example, they're just moving out of frame, which is not a problem. So they just leave the frame and then I don't care anymore what they do, and I can just leave them there. There are other shapes where I do care. For example, I have created some small shapes for the inside of the hand, and let's just see where we have this. So here, or let me zoom in here, I have some small area where I think that I should be able to see through the hand, and the same for the other hand. There are a few short places where this is the case. And now, what do I do with a shape like this? Because I only want this active in a few places. So what you should do is animate the level. And in this case, I even have something semi-transparent, but usually you just go from 0 to 1. So what I have done here, let's take this as an example. So my shape here is here it's largest, so I can look through. Then here it's getting a bit smaller, and then it's hidden. Actually, it should be hidden once earlier, so I made a mistake here. Let's correct it. So what I need to do is here I still see it, so I place a keyframe. Then one frame earlier here it shouldn't be visible, so I bring the level up to 0. So this way I activate it over one frame. I activate the shape, then it's there. It's active, and then here the hand is turning and I should no longer be able to see through, and I deactivate it like this from one frame to the next. Now, sometimes you see people move shapes out of the frame. So for example, if you no longer need this shape, so sometimes people take it and move it like outside so that it's no longer visible here. You can do that. However, you should do this after deactivation. And the reason is, and after bringing the level down to 0. And the reason is that any movement, also movement out of frame, can cause motion blur if you use motion blur, if you enable motion blur. And we will enable it later and I will show you. So it's generally, even if you don't know yet if you use motion blur or not, while creating the shapes, think about that. Think about that the movement of the shape should be realistic one frame longer than the shape is active. So in this is the last frame where I use this shape. If I do use motion blur, then the motion fusion calculates the motion at this point by going back and forth and considering the motion from the previous frame to the current frame to the next frame. So I want to make sure that this motion is still accurate. So I move this shape even one frame more than I need it. So here it's already deactivated. I still move it. And if I want to bring it out of frame, I can now move it out of frame. After this, I can bring it to the side. If I find it distracting to have shapes here which are deactivated, if I find that distracting, I can move them out of the frame to the side. But keep the motion itself accurate for one frame longer than you need the shape. Thank you for watching this lesson from my compositing training course. This course builds strong foundations in the art and craft of compositing with Fusion. It covers topics from rotoscoping, keying, integration, 3D camera tracking, all the way up to topics like projection and multipass compositing. And it goes into a level of depth that very few online courses reach. If you're interested, check out the course page for further details, have a look what other students are saying about this course, and I'd be very happy to welcome you inside.